Welcome to Pressstorm TV. We're in the middle of a series where we're talking about the Nazarite challenge. Last time we talked about the grape challenge. Today we're going to be talking about the fact that in Numbers chapter 6, the Nazarites were told they cannot touch a dead body. They can't even go to their parents' funeral or any of their family members. So James, how do we interpret that in the New Testament if we're wanting to take a Nazarite vow? Like the Apostle Paul actually took a Nazarite vow in Acts 18:18. So how do we interpret that in contemporary society? Don't touch a dead body.
Yeah, the way I interpret that in the New Testament is a dead represents sin and represents things that actually contaminates us in many ways. So the Bible talks about us walking and living holy. And I think there's a call in our generation to be set apart to God in holiness, because the level of perversion we're experiencing in this generation is unlike no other. So when he says, as part of the Nazarite vow, not to go near any dead thing, well, don't go near anything that looks like sin and find comfort in it. Don't compromise, you know, avoid the appearance of evil. It's a calling to a high standard of holiness. I think in P. Gregg's kind of The Vision poem, there's a line that says, holiness that hurts the eyes. It's that concept of God calling us to a life of being set apart to him in a radical devotion, because the level of darkness and perversion in our generation is so intense. We have to be intense on the other extreme in our devotion to God and in our holiness and set apartness to him.
I think that's really powerful, because the thing that maybe doesn't make so much sense to us is within the Jewish civil system, if they touched a dead body, they'd be considered ceremonially unclean and they couldn't bring a sacrifice before God, or the priests wouldn't be allowed to enter into the temple. And it's that sense of uncleanliness. Mm-hmm. Now, uncleanliness isn't just about, oh, you're not a good person or got your second favorite. Uncleanliness is our capacity to come before a clean God. Mm-hmm. And I think the Apostle Paul, who, as we said, seems to have taken a Nazarite vow, mm-hmm. in 2 Timothy, which is his last letter mm-hmm. that we have, written to his spiritual son, often it's called his last will and testament, he writes in 2 Timothy 2, 20, this incredible metaphor, which I really think captures the essence of being a Nazarite. And he says, in a great house, there's lots of different dishes, lots of different bowls. Some of them are used for uncleanness, like your poop scoop kind of thing. And other stuff is used for clean things, like eating on. You eat on a plate, right? And what he said is, if anybody cleanses themselves from these things, he can be useful to the master for any good work. And this isn't about being super spiritual. The Nazarite vow is not about being like holier than thou. It's actually about being more useful to God, mm-hmm. cleansing ourselves of some of these different things and being more useful. If I was going to inject you with a antivirus thing or something like that, one thing you'd want to know is the syringe clean? Because if you put great like medicine in a dirty syringe, it corrupts it. In the same way, God wants to use you as a vessel for him to speak through, to love through, to bring justice through. But it also means that our role is to be as clean a vessel as possible. You know, when you preach through your personality. When you minister, you still minister through your personality. And so part of this process is about saying, God, cleanse me from things that are not of use so that I can be useful to you, just like Paul said about that clean vessel.
Yeah, absolutely. I think holiness is such a significant theme in our generation. I like to put it this way, that God is raising up an army in these end days. And the message of holiness may not be popular, may not draw a crowd, but that's the message that will build the army of God. We can't be a people that are wanting more of the Holy Spirit while we live unholy lives. I mean, it's called Holy Spirit for a reason. He wants to invade us because he's holy. And our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. So there's a certain calling that God has in us if we're going to carry the Holy Spirit in a new measure. And in our generation, sometimes people get carried away and think the grace of God is God kind of excusing sin, and God kind of like, oh yeah, it doesn't matter anymore. No, actually, the grace of God is God empowering us to live holy, empowering us to do His will. Now, there are different dimensions and definitions in the grace of God, but I think there is an understanding that we need to grab hold of, especially in this concept of holiness, that grace empowers us to live in a way that honors God. Grace does not empower us for carnality and empower us to live in compromised lifestyles. If we're going to see God change the nation and the nations, and we're wanting to take this vow, one of the requirements God is calling us is a new standard of holiness. And that's what it means not to touch a dead thing.
Yeah. And one of the things about not touching a dead thing is we know in modern society, you don't leave dead animals or dead people lying around. Why? Because death is contagious. Yeah. And that's why you have to separate yourself from it. And so just in the same way that the first vow was about abstaining from things that are legitimately pleasurable, I think this vow is also about separating yourself from things that can cause death. Mm. And we live in a great generation, but it is also a hyper-connected generation. Mm. So for me, when I interpret this into my life, I'm thinking about how much of the news am I watching? Mm. I'm thinking about how much content am I consuming on social media? Okay. I'm thinking about actually taking a period of time where I'm going off those things, where I'm purposely not watching those, or and separating myself, like you said at the beginning, we disconnect so that we can reconnect.
Yes, yes,
we
absolutely
disconnect from the things of this world that cause death so we can reconnect to God. So how would you interpret that for us?
So I think about Genesis, when God created Adam and Eve, and God gave the commandment and said to them not to eat of the tree. And He said, the day you eat of this tree, you shall die. And them eating of the tree was really an act of disobedience. It's a sinful act. So the act of disobedience, God connected to spiritual death. In the same way in the New Testament, we are called to live holy and live a life that's fully given to God in obedience. Because if we don't, we're actually dying or playing with things that are dead. Yeah. So we end up in a place disconnected from God. And it's amazing that in Genesis, when they sinned, it was like they noticed they were naked, but it wasn't like they died instantly. It was like a gradual process. Yeah. So sometimes the process of death is not always instantaneous, especially spiritually. It can be gradual, and you actually don't realize what's happened until you look back 6 months down the line, 3 months down, 2 weeks down, you're like, well, how did I get here? But it's been a gradual process of death that started a lot earlier because of disobedience.
And what the amazing thing there is that death literally itself means separation. So separating yourself from death means separating yourself from the things that cause spiritual separation between you and God. So if you're going to join us in the Nazarite challenge and take a Nazarite vow, think about, ask the Holy Spirit to reveal in your life what things you need to separate yourself from that are causing separation between you and God. Things that get in the way of your intimacy with God. It could be relationships. It could be things that you're consuming. It could even be sleep. And you need to get up a little bit earlier to spend that time with God. So we're going to be here next week talking about the third section of the vow. Join us.